Lately, a lot of my content has focused on the United States. There are a few different reasons for this as well. First, that's where I live. Second, relatively speaking, it is the largest video game consumption market on the planet, beaten only by China, but if you take into consideration the massive population difference and the fact that the market differential is still extremely small, even with the massive population gap, it is by far the largest consumption market in a general industry sense. And lastly, there has been a large amount of scrutiny aimed at video games in the United States recently, which is a product of misplaced scapegoating in the wake of national tragedy, as well as a lingering effort to regulate loot box and pay-to-win microtransaction economies in games because of their predatory nature. All of this combined has skewed the coverage towards this one area, not to mention the fact that most of my audience is from the United States as well, so it just sort of makes sense. But today, I want to turn and discuss a different nation, one with an even worse fundamental structure when it comes to video games than the United States, which is truly difficult to do. The country is Australia, and to be clear, this is a video meant to analyze their pathetically outdated and woefully incomplete video game regulation framework, not a slight against residents, citizens, or gamers who reside in the nation. The problem for Australia lies within its rating system. Say what you want about the ESRB, which is the local United States rating committee, at least the ESRB has a complete rating scale. In Australia, the rating system for video games previously only went to MA15+. This means that video games were technically either available to everyone 15 and over, at the highest possible maturity level, or they got banned. There was no classification in their format for a truly mature game. There was no equivalent to mature 17+, or adults only 18+ from the ESRB, or PEGI 18 in Europe. It was essentially similar to having a movie rating scale where R-rated movies aren't allowed. It only goes to PG-13. It was idiocy. However, as this glaringly inadequate system came under fire, Australia developed a rather odd solution. Instead of crafting a new and reasonable category for 18+ games, or 17+, whatever it may be, they effectively just pushed the MA15+ rating up one notch to 18+. This technically solved the problem of having an incomplete scale, but did it really? The problem now was that mature games were being rated on a system majorly designed to evaluate games for mid and early teens, and the resulting confusion is both comical and absurd. The clarification for this R18+ framework is as follows. The content is high in impact. R18+ material is restricted to adults. Such material may contain classifiable elements such as sex scenes and drug use that are high in impact. Some material classified R18+ may be offensive to sections of the adult community. A person may be asked for proof of their age before purchasing, hiring, or viewing R18+ films and computer games at a retail store or cinema. Here's the question. What does that even mean? High impact sex sounds like Ronda Rousey just busted your bedroom door down and is about to get spicy with you. There is no clarification of terms, no explanation as to what is and is not high impact violence or sex, and overall it reads like the ending paragraph of a college kid's book report that got finished an hour before class and was just put in to meet some arbitrary page requirement deadline and means absolutely nothing. Yet again, though the ESRB may be an organization with extreme flaws, I'm not going to dispute that at this time, if we examine the ratings requirements and descriptions for ESRB categories, we can see actual descriptions of problematic content. There is an emphasis on gambling, prolonged scenes of nudity, or mutilation of body parts for the violence section. And though it isn't perfect, you can at least get a somewhat well-rounded idea of what games will conflict with what specific category points. And when the sum total of your description is high impact, what the hell does that even mean? And who decides on a day-to-day basis what it means for that particular game? This brings us to Kingdom Come Deliverance. Kingdom Come Deliverance is a game that has been out for quite some time, and has also been publishing DLC content for that entire duration. Also, it's a very good game. I would highly suggest checking it out if you have any interest in medieval subject matter, RPGs, or anything like that. But yeah, it's open world as well. It's a pretty good game. Recently, the game was inexplicably banned in Australia because of its depiction of, here we go again, high-impact sexual content. This was quickly reversed in the previous tag of R18+ bestowed upon the game once again because the title has in fact been rated multiple times previously at R18+ and introduced nothing out of the ordinary in the way of high impact violence and sexual content, whatever that even is, that it did not already have for the previous ratings. But the mere fact that this issue occurred highlights that the ratings board and system has no idea what it even is or how to operate. Now, one could make the argument that this was just a mistake, but there are far too many additional examples for that to hold up for very long. Next is DayZ. DayZ is a violent game depicting zombies, weapons, and various other somewhat mature themes. The game was largely accepted elsewhere in the world, though not particularly popular to some gamers, but that's beside the point. However, Australia slapped it with a flat-out ban. This ban had nothing to do with violence or sexual content. This ban had to do with the immutable doctrine of never allowing drug use when associated with rewards of any kind. DayZ let a player smoke pot in the game, and it would restore some health. Oh, how diabolical. And because of that tiny detail, the game was refused classification and told it must change that display or remain banned. This is made further confusing by the claim that if the game removed the cannabis, it would be classified as MA15+, which is also a rating that discusses high-impact violence with near-identical language to 18+, but somehow DayZ, with zombies and gore, would be 15+, while other titles with similar material would be rated higher. This again speaks to the subjectivity and complete idiocy of their rating system and board. Whatever is decided on any given day to be high impact can result in a game's classification refusal, and when you combine that with the only other clear parameters being absolutely archaic, such as drug use tied to incentives of any kind being banned at all levels, it starts to become obvious that the moderation policy Australia has with regards to video games is neither intelligent nor functional. There are many different examples of banned titles to choose from. Some of the titles have been updated, reformatted, or censored so as to be able to sell some sort of version in Australia, but when comparing Australia and its censorship policies to most other nations around the globe, a very clear pattern begins to emerge. The most confusing thing, however, is that this rating system is not evenly applied between games and other media. Horror movies and other cinematic films often contain far worse imagery and themes than their video game relatives, and yet games are moderated and censored under a framework that can only be described as repetitive and ill-defined with much greater intensity. Branching out, one can see that medical cannabis, much like in the United States, is gaining traction in Australia, and rightly so. Medical marijuana is legal, and there is a definitive push for recreational use as well. But in a video game, the simple act of smoking that replenishes some health results in a game receiving a flat-out ban and being refused classification. From everything I can gather, the framework is headed for change as of right now, but Australia has a long history with government-mandated censorship, and that change may come later rather than sooner. The problem actually extends past the ratings board and its incomplete guidelines, and lands on the government itself. Australia, for a very long time, has embraced the idea of mandated public safety and censorship to protect against imagery that is undesirable to the public interest, but the public interest is determined and defined by a disconnected regulatory body. Here is a historic snapshot of the cinematography regulations from the 1926 Act showing what content can be censored or removed from public consumption. No film shall be registered which, in the opinion of a censor, is A. blasphemous, indecent, or obscene, B. is likely to be injurious to morality or to encourage or incite a crime, C. is likely to be offensive to the people of any friendly nation, D. is likely to be offensive to the people of the British Empire, or E. depicts any matter that the exhibition of which is undesirable in the public interest. Realistically, because of the rise in digital distribution, obtaining a banned video game in Australia is extremely easy. In fact, many players might not even be aware of certain titles being banned, since the largest impact is a prohibition on the physical brick-and-mortar sales of the game, but the fact remains, even if it is easy to obtain something that is in essence banned or prohibited by the government, that does not change the fact that the systems in place allowing such a ban to even occur must be looked at and, in this case, reformatted. The primary justification for these outdated ideologies that allow for the inconsistent treatment of gaming versus traditional film is that somehow interactive content causes a user to exhibit replicative behavior. If you play a violent video game, you will be violent. If you smoke in a video game, you will smoke in real life, etc., etc. This mindset is not based on even a shred of reality. The data is not there to support this idea, and yet it persists long after it should have disappeared long ago, in many more nations than is reasonable, because it is easier for an age demographic a decade or two outside the exponential curve of technology to retroactively examine and demonize something they do not understand, rather than undertake the more meaningful and difficult task of re-evaluating and updating their own existing laws and ideas. The United States comes under fire rather often for antiquated policy or social norms. It's been in the spotlight quite a bit as of late with regards to gaming specifically, as once again a resurgence in the 90s idea that video games are somehow a scourge on family life and public safety rears its ugly, disingenuous head. But even as that occurs, it's important to realistically highlight all areas of inconsistency around the globe, not just the ones that are immediately present in our path. Again, this is not an attack on Australian gamers. Far from it. In fact, if anything, I would hope that somehow the regulatory framework can change sooner rather than later, because Cyberpunk 2077 is on the horizon, and I see a high probability that it somehow is deemed to contain high impact violence and sex, which would result in its effective ban in Australia. That would not render it unobtainable, not by any stretch, I'm not making that case, but it would make the game more difficult for certain groups of gamers to participate in. It would push players towards digital distribution, which may be unappealing to some who prefer physical copies, and overall, the system needs to change. It may seem like a rather odd topic, but censorship in gaming is an issue I find myself increasingly passionate about. So here I am, discussing censorship that really doesn't even apply to me, because if we restrict our frame of focus to only things that apply to us in the here and now as individuals, we make it far easier for selective censorship policies to proliferate and thrive. That's it for today, though. If you want to support, there are links down below, memberships, merch, that kind of thing, but I'll cut it there and stop rambling. As always, thank you all for watching, and have a nice night.